This is Good Morning Indiana, working for you.
It is 5 o'clock on your Monday. Good morning to you. I'm Lauren Casey. Here's what's making headlines on this June 29th. We are following breaking news this morning after a juvenile was shot and killed near the canal downtown. Our Alyssa Donovan has the latest from the scene in a live report.
Just wanted to get out there and get to them. I didn't know how long they'd already been in the water.
An IMPD officer being called a hero for helping rescue two teens after their car crashed into a pond. How he's describing the moments he tried to save their lives. And 31 states across the U.S. are seeing a surge in COVID-19 cases. We'll show you the latest hot spots and where Indiana stands. But first, we do need to get a check of your Storm Team 6 forecast. Todd Klassen is standing by from home right now. And Todd, we are starting a brand new work week, but a lot of the same in the weather department, right?
Yeah, it really is. You know, over the weekend, we told you the humidity was going to come up. It really, really did. Saturday was a lot wetter than the day on Sunday. And probably thinking today more like Sunday than compared to Saturday with just some isolated storms that'll be making their way through the area. And we're already dealing with some of these storms across southern portions of central Indiana as they've been rocking and rolling through Bedford and now pushing into far southwestern portions of Jackson County there. But you can see the rain extends all the way up through Bloomington and Spencer. But these are the only games in town as far as storms go. The rest of central Indiana this morning is pretty quiet with partly cloudy skies, but it's still very, very unsettled across the area with a lot of humidity around, and we'll fire up more storms during the peak heating of the day with these heavier downpours, although we're not expecting any severe weather. Warm and muggy this morning with temperatures in the 60s and 70s. We're on our way up to a high today of 90 degrees with partly sunny skies. But again, once we especially get into the peak heating of the day, there'll be the chance of scattered storms off and on throughout much of the afternoon and into the evening hours. Lauren.
All right, Todd, thank you. Another violent weekend across Indianapolis. Police are investigating multiple shootings, the most recent one happening just hours ago near the canal. Our Alyssa Donovan is joining us live this morning from that scene with more details. Alyssa, good morning.
Good morning, Lauren. And we don't know much right now. What we do know is that the victim in this shooting was taken to the hospital in critical condition. We do know that it was a juvenile as well. But besides that, we're still waiting to learn exactly what led up to this shooting. We know that when police arrived here to this address, it's right on the corner of North Street and Senate, and near the canal. We know that they arrived here right around 2 a.m. on reports of shots fired. When they arrived, they did encounter a large gathering of people, and then they did start to question some of those people on the details of this shooting. It happened around 2 this morning, as I said, and when police arrived, they said there was a large group of people here. They've been interviewing witnesses that were around at the time of the shooting. Earlier, police responded to another shooting as well. That one happened in the 1700 block of North Somerset Avenue. Police tell us when they arrived, two people had been shot, one in serious condition. The victims telling officers that they were inside their home when bullets came through the house in an apparent drive-by shooting. Since Friday afternoon, 16 people have been shot across the Circle City. One of the victims in a shooting on Friday afternoon has died. And we are still waiting to learn exactly what happened here near the canal at this shooting. We do know, as I said, that a juvenile was involved in this shooting. He is at the hospital in critical condition right now. And of course, we'll bring you those details as soon as we learn them, as soon as they're available from police. But at this time, if you know any details about any of the shootings that happened over the weekend, you are asked to call Crime Stoppers. That number is 317-262-TIPS. Reporting live, Alyssa Donovan, RTV6.
Alyssa, thank you. And you mentioned that drive-by shooting. We have more details on that. It happened overnight. Two people are recovering after that shooting. It took place on the west side. This happened around 11:45 Sunday night near 17th and Somerset Avenue. That's just west of 16th and Tibbs. The victim tells us that they were inside the home when bullets came through the walls. According to officers, the victims believe the shooting was a drive-by, but they are not cooperating with the investigation. At 5:05, a teenage boy is fighting for his life, and a teenage girl is dead after a car they were in went off the road and ended up in a pond on the southeast side on Saturday evening. This morning, an IMPD officer is being credited for his heroic efforts after he pulled two of them from the water. Our Kelsey Anderson joins us this morning as he walks us through what happened the moments he tried to jump in and save their lives.
Within 10 minutes of that call coming in, Officer Jared Allen was able to rescue both teens from the submerged vehicle. Unfortunately, one of the teens did not survive.
We have one car in the water, total four patients. Two are trapped in the vehicle.
This is the call that came over the police scanner around 7 p.m. Saturday night. Officer Jared Allen was one of the first to respond to the scene. Immediately, witnesses told him there were still two people trapped in the car. Allen, who is a three-year veteran with the department, was a collegiate swimmer and went through water rescue training in the police academy. But this was the first time he put his skills to use.
I had a rough idea of where the car might be. I mean, I'm 6 foot six, so I used my length to an advantage. I put my feet down, finally was able to find the top of the car. After that, I started doing some controlled dives down, was able to find some openings and start reaching around and seeing if I could find the kids.
Both teens were transported to local hospitals. The teenage girl dying in the hospital from her injuries. The teenage boy now fighting for his life. Investigators say the 17-year-old driver and another 16-year-old passenger are in good physical condition. Witnesses did report seeing the car traveling at a high rate of speed on Fry Road before hitting a tree and going into the pond. IMPD is still investigating why the car left the road. A petition on change.org now has more than 7,000 signatures in hopes of getting a guardrail put in on this section of Fry Road where the accident happened. I'm Kelsey Anderson, RTV 6.
Kelsey, thank you. The time now is 5:07. Starting this week, it will no longer be legal to hold your cell phone while you're driving in the state of Indiana. The state's new hands-free driving law will go into effect Wednesday. That's July 1st. You will be allowed to use your phone with hands-free devices and voice-operated technology. The law says it's okay for a driver to hold the phone in an emergency situation. Violators will be subject to a fine, but will not lose points on their license while the law is phased in the first year. There are a few other Indiana laws that are going into effect on Wednesday as well that we want you to know about. One will separate teacher evaluations from required state testing. Another will ban panhandling in Indianapolis. People will not be allowed to panhandle within 50 feet of an ATM, entrance of a business, parking garage, parking meter, or public monument. This law has brought some controversy, with the ACLU of Indiana calling it, quote, unconstitutional. Now to the latest on the COVID-19 outbreak. After new cases were reported over the weekend, Indiana has confirmed nearly 45,000 total cases. More than 800 new cases were reported this weekend. The Indiana State Department of Health also confirmed 3 new deaths Sunday, which is down from 21 on Saturday. More than 2,400 Hoosiers have died so far from that virus. 470,000 people in our state have been tested so far. 31 states are now reporting an increase in coronavirus cases. 23 of them are also reporting an increase in hospitalizations. As we look ahead to the July 4th holiday, more cities and towns are closing their bars and beaches. ABC's Andrea Fujii has the very latest.
This morning, at least a dozen cities and states rolling back reopening as coronavirus cases surge. On Sunday, states reported 42,000 new cases. California shutting down bars in Los Angeles and several other counties just 1 week after LA bars reopened from the lockdown. As cases grow in Pittsburgh, starting Tuesday, the city's restaurants and bars can't serve alcohol. It will be takeout only. White House officials sounding the alarm.
The window is closing. We have to act, and people as individuals have to act responsibly. We need to social distance. We need to wear our face coverings.
In Texas, Vice President Mike Pence also stressing the need for masks.
Wearing a mask is just a good idea.
For nearly a week now, Texas has had more than 5,000 new cases a day. In Houston and San Antonio, millions of residents received an emergency text urging them to stay home to reduce the virus spread. So far, more than 125,000 people have died in the U.S., including Allie Guidry from Louisiana. The pregnant 29-year-old, whose family said she had no underlying health issues, died after 3 weeks on a ventilator. Doctors were able to deliver her baby 4 months early.
Take the virus seriously, but don't stop living your life. Just be cautious, because when you think it can't happen to you, it can happen.
7 states shattering new case records this weekend, including Florida. Broward County joining Miami-Dade, closing beaches for the upcoming 4th of July weekend. But so far, the governor refusing to issue a statewide order, saying younger people are driving up the numbers. In Arizona, the state setting back-to-back records for hospitalizations. Only 13% of ICU beds are available. Cases in Nevada also rising. 3 weeks after Las Vegas casinos reopened, Caesars now saying an employee died after testing positive. Andrea Fuji, ABC News, New York.
As the pandemic continues, food banks in central Indiana say they're in need of supplies now more than ever. Gleaners Food Bank says it's serving more than twice as many people as normal. In order to get what they need for the COVID-19 family box distribution model, they need a minimum of $500,000 in weekly donations. The CEO says buying food costs 8 times the amount as the same period last year because of the disruptions in the supply chain. We talked to a volunteer this weekend at Gleaners Mobile Food Pantry site who says at the end of the day, we're all humans, so it's important that we work together.
There's always a need to feed families, and we don't want anybody ever to go hungry, but some of the economic impact, children not being in school and receiving those meals has definitely increased the need. And there was a lot of fear in the beginning too. There still is a lot of fear.
If you are struggling and you need food, there are several opportunities this week to get your food. This afternoon in Decatur County, food will be distributed at Greensburg Elementary School from 4 to 6. On Tuesday, you can visit the Hamilton County Fairgrounds also from 4 to 6 or Greencastle Christian Church. To help Hoosier families that rely on Gleaners, you can click on the Give tab on their website. The time right now is 5:12. Let's check in with Todd Clausen and see what we can expect as we head out the door this Monday morning.
Lauren, more of the same in the forecast that we experienced over the weekend. A lot of humidity, a lot of heat around, and there will be the chance of some storms out there throughout the course of the week. The good news is I think the bulk of the stormy activity is probably earlier on in the week compared to later in the week as we get into the holiday weekend. So that will be good news. You can see those rain chances decrease as we start to get into Friday and Saturday. But as of right now, we are dealing with some storms down near Bloomington and Bedford. The rest of Central Indiana is pretty quiet. The storms in the southern portions of the state right along this front. Notice how skinny it is, but that rain stretches all the way down into portions of North Carolina. So additional storms will fire up this afternoon in the heating of the day. You notice temperatures back in the 85 to 90 degree range with quite a bit of humidity as well. We'll talk more about the rest of the week and look ahead to the holiday weekend coming up in Maine weather in just a few minutes. Lauren.
All right, Todd, thank you. After calls for change, the Confederate emblem could be removed from Mississippi's flag. The next step the state is taking to redesign. And the NFL has handed down a punishment to the New England Patriots. Still ahead, what they're losing for illegal filming last season. The time right now is 5:13. Stick around, we'll be right back.
Bachelor's Greatest Seasons, new ABC Tonight.
Welcome back. The Mississippi State Legislature has passed a bill to remove the Confederate emblem from their flag with a referendum. It will now go to Governor Tate Reeves, who says he'll sign it. The bill will establish a commission to redesign the flag and mandates that it includes the phrase, "In God We Trust." Other than that, voters will have the final say when it appears on the ballot this November. Mississippi is the last state with a Confederate battle emblem as part of its flag, but others still include Confederate imagery in their designs. President Trump's campaign says rallies in Florida and Arizona will be postponed as both states there are seeing a surge in COVID-19 cases. Vice President Mike Pence was scheduled to make campaign stops there during his trips to meet with the governors and healthcare leaders. He's still expected to visit for those meetings next week. Pence did still speak at the Celebrate Freedom rally in a Dallas church yesterday where around 2,200 people were in attendance. Former South Bend mayor and Democratic presidential candidate Pete Buttigieg is getting a new job. He'll be teaching and doing research at the University of Notre Dame this upcoming school year. The university announced that Buttigieg will work on research on how to restore trust in political institutions and the forces that shape the 2020s. Notre Dame says he will also teach an undergraduate course on the importance of trust in different fields. In Massachusetts, a hospital had to be evacuated after severe thunderstorms caused major flooding. Officials say the storms flooded the parking lot and caused water to burst through the Norwood Hospital doors. All ICU patients were safely relocated. Multiple cars there were underwater and others were trapped in the streets, and police say that no one was hurt. Back here at home at 5:18, some areas are seeing a little bit of rain this morning. Todd, where are those at?
Yeah, down in southern locations, central Indiana, Lauren, Bloomington to Bedford, over towards the Spencer area. We've been dealing with these showers and storms, but most of central Indiana is pretty quiet here this morning. But we will expect to fire up more additional storms throughout the course of the day. But let's talk about what's happening, though, currently across the area. Some heavier downpours, a little bit of lightning just south of downtown Bloomington, a little closer to Lake Monroe as you work your way there down US 37 or State Road 37, and then some rain back towards Spencer to US 231 there, and we'll slide a little further to the south. The heaviest of the rain has now pushed south of US 50 in Jackson County, and the lightning's really kind of tailed off on that system as well. And so there's nothing severe this morning, but you may hear a rumble of thunder if you're in southern locations. But other than that, quiet across the rest of central Indiana. You see exactly how skinny that band of rain is, but it does extend from Indiana all the way down into portions of North Carolina. More storms up near Minneapolis. There's clouds and some unsettled weather off to our west near St. Louis. And all this is going to kind of just head our way throughout the course of the next few days. So we'll keep rain chances in the forecast as we go throughout the course of the day. You notice they flare up more throughout the afternoon hours during the peak heating of the day. And some of these storms will probably linger past sunset as well. So that's something we'll keep an eye on. Again, mainly rainmakers, some lightning mixed in, but not expecting widespread or any severe weather for that matter. Temperatures are in the 60s and 70s this morning. The dew points today are extremely high. It is going to be a very, very uncomfortable day. As those dew points are in the mid-70s. When you think of dew points in the mid-70s, you have to think of Florida during the summertime. That's normally what you could see. So you're going to work up a sweat very, very quickly if you are outside. As temperatures climb into the upper 80s to right around 90 degrees for the day today. Overnight tonight, we're going back down into the 70s. So very similar to tomorrow morning to what's happening outside right now. And then as we continue throughout the day tomorrow, probably a little more in the way of cloud cover for your Tuesday. That keeps the temperatures down a little bit across the area, but still the chance of some scattered storms in the forecast. And those storms are going to be a pretty consistent theme throughout the course of this week. Temperatures 85 to 90 degrees. The good news is, though, as we do get into Friday, which is the observed holiday, and the 4th of July on Saturday officially, and then even into Sunday, it only looks like about a 20% chance of isolated storms. So the wetter portion of the week will be the beginning of the week, but it does remain pretty warm and muggy, Lauren, into the holiday weekend.
All right, Todd, thank you. Let's take a look at traffic right now as you're heading out on the roads this Monday. Here's a look on the west side, I-465 near Rockville Road. Traffic is moving along up to speed, both northbound and southbound. No issues to slow you down. It is 521. JP Morgan Chase says it's corrected a technical problem that it showed some customers the wrong account balances. Many took to social media this weekend to complain about the issue. Chase says a glitch delayed updates to what customers saw in their checking accounts through the website and the mobile app. In a tweet, the bank says everything has now been fixed. Big news for the New England Patriots this morning. The NFL team is being punished for their crews filming the Cincinnati Bengals and the Cleveland Browns back in December. They will be fined $1.1 million and lose a third-round draft pick next year. Their television crew will also not be allowed to film any games in the 2020 season. The Patriots admitted to the inappropriate filming, saying that they were credentialed to shoot video for the team's web series on an advanced scout. NASA is challenging you to design their next device for astronauts on the moon, a toilet. Just after the break, what they want it to do and the cash prize they have that is up for grabs. It's 522. Stick around. We'll be right back.
Bills to Cleaners Food Bank of Indiana.
Welcome back to Good Morning Indiana. The time right now is 5:25. Here's a live look at your commute on the southeast side. I-465, a view near Arlington Avenue where traffic's picking up and it's traveling smoothly. No crashes, no delays right now to slow down your commute. Well, NASA is asking for your help to improve technology in space, specifically toilets. Space Agency says they need a new design for a future lunar mission. They want to send astronauts back to the moon by 2024, and they say existing space toilets are not designed for lunar gravity. gravity. So they want the global community to send their ideas in the Lunar Lood Challenge. They want a design that can be used both in lunar and microgravity, as well as being smaller and more efficient than the current ones. Winning submissions can win up to $35,000 in the contest, and submissions are due by August 17th, and they can be sent into NASA's website. I guess I never thought about toilets on the moon, Todd, so there you go. I guess it's something you need.
Yeah, I like the name on it, the Lunar Loo. Just make it comfortable. That's all I have to say. All right, outside right now, we're dealing with some storms making their way through parts of the area. The lightning's kind of tailed off on these storms across the Bedford area, back into Bloomington as well as Spencer. And honestly, the rain's not as heavy either, as it kind of weakens and slides off towards the south. And these are the only showers that we have out there right now. Otherwise, we are partly cloudy this morning, very warm and very muggy. High temperatures today, right back up to around 90 degrees as far as the storms go today. Outside of the ones that are out there right now, I do think we get a break throughout much of the morning. And then as we get into the afternoon hours, that's when we'll start to fire them up once again. But prepare for that heat and humidity. We'll prepare you for what's coming up in the next half hour of Good Morning Indiana. Stay with us. We'll be back in just a couple minutes.
It takes energy to share your energy.
This is Good Morning Indiana, working for you.
Another night of violence here in the Circle City. Now at 5:30, the latest on the investigation into a shooting on the canal that left one person dead.
And one teen is dead, another fighting for his life after their vehicle ended up in a retention pond this morning. We're hearing from the heroic police officer who tried to save their lives. Welcome and good morning to you on this Monday, June the 29th. I'm Rafael Sanchez, and welcome to Good Morning Indiana. Lauren, I hope you had a great weekend.
I did, Rafael. It was a little bit muggy out there, but we did need some rain, so that is the good news. And Todd, what can we expect as we head into our Monday? Kind of more of the same, right?
Yeah, you know, there's more rain chances in this forecast. And in fact, on Saturday, some areas in central Indiana saw more rain in one day than they had in the entire month. I know the timing wasn't great with it being the weekend, but we really did need the rain. As far as rain chances today, there's some spotty ones out there right now this morning, but better rain chances will actually enter the forecast later on this afternoon and into the evening hours. But here's what we're currently dealing with. And the lightning's tailed off, and the heaviest of the rain has come to an end, but some scattered showers from Spencer to Bloomington down towards the Seymour area this morning. There's also a lot of moisture in the air, and that's creating some patchy fog out there. Bloomington, 2 miles, reduced a little bit more on the far eastern side of the state. So just be aware of that if you are going to be out and about. But otherwise, look at these temperatures at 5:31 this morning. We are in the 60s and 70s. We're back into the upper 80s to right around 90 degrees with better storm chances today during the peak heating of the day. We'll talk more about that for you, Lauren, coming up here in just a couple minutes.
Todd, thanks. And you can see some fog right now from our camera here. This is on the southeast side. A live look at I-74 and Post Road. You can barely see the interstate. You really only can due to the headlights there. So just use your low beams and use caution. Leave a little bit more space between you and the vehicle in front of you as we head into our Monday morning. Well, new this morning, we are following breaking news involving a shooting on the canal here in downtown Indianapolis.
And Lauren, our Alyssa Donovan joins us live this morning with what she's learning. Alyssa, what are police telling you happened this morning?
You know, Rafael, we're still working to learn more details on what exactly led up to this shooting here near the canal. But what we do know right now is that the victim in this shooting has died. And we also know that victim was a juvenile. So we are working to learn more information at this hour. But police were called here to the 300 block of Walnut Street. That's right near the canal off of Senate Avenue. That was right around 2 this morning on reports of shots fired. When they arrived, they found the victim as well as what they described as a large gathering of people. We're told they're talking to witnesses now. The victim was taken to a nearby hospital in critical condition where he later died. Now, this adds to a violent weekend across the Circle City. Since Friday afternoon, 16 people have been shot. This morning's shooting, one of two shootings that were deadly. And as I said, police are still working to learn more information on what exactly led to the shooting that happened here at the canal and what exactly happened after that shooting, what that gathering of people was all about as well. So if you have any information that could help police in their investigation on this shooting or any of the crimes that happened over this weekend, you are asked to call Crime Stoppers. That number is 317-262-TIPS. Reporting live, Alyssa Donovan, RTV6.
Alyssa, thank you. The time right now is 5:34. This morning, a Kokomo woman is taking legal action after she says corrections officers at the Howard County Jail sexually assaulted her. Sheena Turner was an inmate at the jail back in February. She says she was sexually assaulted on two occasions by two different corrections officers. Sheena and her attorney have filed a tort claim against the Howard County Sheriff's Office and jail, putting them on notice of the intent to sue for negligence.
I just don't feel like it's right what they did. And I'm sure this happens at plenty of jails, and a lot of people don't say anything, probably because they look at it as, you know, oh, well, I'm the inmate and they're the correctional officer. They're not going to believe me.
Well, Shana reported the allegations to the sheriff's office. In early March, the sheriff announced six employees were terminated at the jail following an internal investigation into, quote, allegations of improper activity with inmates that violated the department policies. Two incidents were referred to the prosecutor's office, but no charges were filed. Shana's attorney says at least one of the officers who touched Shana was among the six who were fired. Sheriff Jerry Asher had no comment about Shana's claims.
The time now is 5:35 here on Good Morning Indiana, and Colts linebacker Darius Leonard is now in the middle of the national discussion on racial profiling. He says he became a victim of discrimination after being kicked out of a Chipotle restaurant in South Carolina. He was out with some friends, in fact, three black men and a biracial woman. They were all eating and having a casual conversation when a white customer reportedly felt threatened. And that customer allegedly told the manager that Leonard and his companions were abusing him and talking trash. Leonard calls that a flat-out lie, but says the group was asked to leave anyway.
That's what being black in America is right now. You know, us not even doing anything wrong, going out to eat with your family, just trying to spend a little bit of quality time, and can't enjoy eating anymore.
Chipotle has suspended the manager involved, and this morning, the restaurant's CEO released a statement saying the company has a zero-tolerance policy for discrimination of any kind. The Colts have also released a statement saying, in part, Darius's experience demonstrates the struggles so many black Americans and people of color face every single day. RTV6 is hosting a virtual town hall covering the history of racial injustice and how we got to where we are today. A panelist will discuss the current state of race relations, how to move forward, and how to deal with interactions with law enforcement. You can watch our conversation on race this Thursday from 7 to 8 p.m. right here on RTV6. Lauren?
Rafael, a teenage boy, is fighting for his life, and a teenage girl is dead after a car they were in ended up in a pond on the southeast side Saturday evening. This morning, an IMPD officer is being credited for his heroic efforts. Kelsey Anderson joins us this morning with how he jumped into action. Kelsey.
It was around 7 p.m. Saturday night that the call came in that a car was submerged in a pond and two teens were trapped inside. That's when Officer Jared Allen sprung into action, rescuing both of those teens from the submerged vehicle.
We have one car in the water, total four patients. Two are trapped in the vehicle.
Allen, who is a three-year veteran with the department, was a collegiate swimmer and went through water rescue training in the police academy. But this was the first time he put his skills to use. Within 10 minutes of the call coming in, Officer Jared Allen had rescued both victims from the submerged vehicle. Unfortunately, one of the teens didn't survive.
I'm sorry. We did everything we could. I just wish that it had a better outcome than it did. So we did everything we could in the moment.
Investigators say the 17-year-old driver and another 16-year-old passenger are in good physical condition. Witnesses did report seeing the car traveling at a high rate of speed on Fry Road before hitting a tree and going into the pond. IMPD is still investigating why the car left the road. A petition on change.org now has more than 7,000 signatures to get a guardrail put in this area off Fry Road where the accident happened. I'm Kelsey Anderson, RTV6.
Kelsey, thank you so much. Now turning to the coronavirus and its impact on our state. This morning, we're breaking down the latest numbers and information from state health leaders. Sunday, three new coronavirus deaths were reported in Indiana. Since the pandemic began, more than 2,400 Hoosiers have died from COVID-19. The state also reported more than 360 new cases. That brings the number of total infected Hoosiers to nearly 45,000. And good news this morning, the positivity rate continues to go down. 9.5% of Hoosiers tested positive for the virus.
And Raphael, some daycare providers across central Indiana are still closed due to the pandemic, but as they prepare to reopen, they're receiving help in the form of thousands of dollars in grant money. Recently, St. Mary's Child Center received $20,000 from the Come Back Stronger Fund. A grant program is supported by Early Learning Indiana and Lilly Endowment. So far, more than 550 child care providers in Indiana have received grants totaling $7.6 million. At St. Mary's, which is located downtown, they're using the money to be able to help protect staff members and children once they return.
We serve vulnerable children. About 93% come from poverty. So 56% of like the 200 kids that come, we raise full scholarships for. So we never have anything extra. And so now we're looking at getting no-touch thermometers, getting all kinds of the masks, getting everything that we need to have everything be safe and good for everyone, but it's a lot.
Well, they also plan to use the money to add additional staff helping with the daily screening process, and they plan to add dividers inside the office area. St. Mary's Child Center plans to reopen on August 3rd.
So you could be a lucky winner right now. If you play the Hoosier Lottery and you bought a ticket on the city's northeast side, you could be a lot richer this morning. And so look at the pockets, look at around the home, because the lottery says a ticket worth $3.2 million. You heard me right, $3.2 million was sold at the Letgo on Oak Landon Road on Saturday. Are you holding the ticket? The winning numbers, 2, 5, 10, 26, 34, and 36. The odds of hitting the Hoosier Lottery jackpot are 1 in 9.3 million. So if you have the ticket, Todd Clawson, go collect your money this morning.
You know, unfortunately, I only had one of the six numbers, Raphael, so we're still working. So we didn't get that, actually. I didn't even buy a ticket. But anyway, congratulations to the big winner there on the north side. All right, outside right now. We're dealing with some isolated storms down to the south. Nothing severe here, but some of you may have woken up with the thunder and lightning down towards the Bloomington and Bedford area. The lightning has since dropped off, and there's just a few heavier downpours right now down here and just south of Bloomington and Lake Monroe, pushing into northern Lawrence County. Another one there in northern Jackson County. But other than that, it's dry this morning. Some patchy fog out there with all the humidity. It's warm and it's muggy. The pool or any body of water will be a great place to be later on this afternoon. But if you are heading to the pool, there will be the chance of thunderstorms later on today on a spotty basis. Obviously, if you hear thunder or see lightning, you need to get out of the water and find shelter with these storms moving through. Nothing severe, but lightning makes all storms dangerous. We'll talk more about your extended forecast coming up in just a little bit.
Todd, thank you so much. Today, members of Congress will be briefed on a report that claims that Russia allegedly paid members of the Taliban to kill U.S. troops in Afghanistan. We'll have the latest from Washington straight ahead. You're watching Good Morning Indiana right here on RTV6.
Harden and strengthen your enamel.
Welcome back. Minneapolis is one step closer to dismantling its police department. The city council has unanimously voted to remove the requirement for the department for the city charter. In place of a, quote, police department, they're proposing a, quote, Department of Community Safety and Violence Prevention. The amendment says it will take a holistic public health oriented approach. It also provides for a law enforcement division with licensed officers, but it doesn't say how many. The Minneapolis police force has come under heavy pressure since the death of George Floyd. The officers charged with his death are due back in court today.
In Colorado, there are now renewed calls for justice for nearly a year after a young black man died in a controversial encounter with police in Aurora. We're talking about Elijah McClain. He died last August after he was confronted by three police officers that he was placed in a chokehold and injected with ketamine by paramedics. This after someone called 911 saying that the 23-year-old who was wearing a mask looked suspicious. The three officers were placed on leave but returned to the force after the district attorney said there was insufficient evidence to support charging them. Colorado's governor has appointed a special prosecutor to re-examine this case.
And this morning, there are new questions surrounding unidentified remains found near Fort Hood, Texas, as a search continues for missing soldier Vanessa Guillen. Those remains were discovered near where the skeletal remains of another soldier, Gregory Weddle Morales, were discovered last week. Officials have said that foul play is suspected in both cases, but they haven't found any credible link between the two disappearances. 20-year-old Guillen was last seen in April. Her family says before she went missing, she told them she had been sexually harassed by a superior, but did not report the incident out of fear of retribution.
The time now is 5:47, and President Trump is pushing back on a bombshell report accusing Russia of offering bounties to the Taliban to kill U.S. soldiers in Afghanistan. The president says he was never briefed on the matter. Members of Congress are now demanding answers. ABC's Alex Crochet has more from Washington.
Overnight, President Trump pushing back on a bombshell New York Times report accusing Russia of offering bounties on U.S. soldiers in Afghanistan. That same report saying the president was briefed on the findings. Trump responded in a tweet that intel told him they did not find this info credible and therefore did not report it to me or Vice President Pence. That report says Russian intelligence officers offered to pay the Taliban to kill American troops amid peace talks to end America's longest war. A military official confirmed the report to ABC News, but did not know if the president had been briefed. The political fallout has been swift.
If it is true, underline the word if, that they are paying surrogates to kill Americans, this is one of the most serious matters, I think, that has arisen in the Trump administration.
Republican Representative Liz Cheney tweeting, if the report is true, why wasn't the president or VP briefed? Who did know and when? And what's been the response?
This is as bad as it gets.
And House Speaker Nancy Pelosi called the president's response totally outrageous.
You would think that the minute the president heard of it, he would want to know more instead of denying that he knew anything.
Pelosi saying top congressional leaders were not aware of the report, but would be investigating to determine if the president was briefed. Last year, 23 U.S. troops died in Afghanistan, but whether any were targeted by Taliban fighters paid by Russian operatives is not known, according to military sources. Still, this is new fuel for Trump's 2020 challenger, Joe Biden.
Donald Trump has continued his embarrassing campaign of deference and debasing himself before Vladimir Putin.
A senior administration official told the Associated Press that the White House plans to brief select members of Congress about the issue later today. Alex Perchet, ABC News, Washington.
All right, it's a warm and muggy start to our work week here across central Indiana. Hope you had a great weekend. I know we dodged some storms and it was needed rainfall. Timing always not that great when it rains on the weekend. But as you start your day here, as you look from downtown to the north, you see the hazy sunshine. The one thing that has not gone away is the humidity. That is going to be with us here throughout the course of the remainder of the day. And really the next couple days, the humidity is going to be very, very high. There's a little bit of patchy fog out there. Some more clouds that are just out there because of the humidity and the moisture rather than the classic fog setup. So it shouldn't be a huge issue for you, but just know that it is possible. There's been some showers down towards the Bloomington area this morning. They're basically falling apart there in Monroe County. A few heavier ones over in just northeast of Bedford and over towards the Seymour area. And these continue to have weakened over the last couple hours, and the lightning has really tailed off. And otherwise, it's a quiet start to our day. And we'll have a lot of hazy sunshine this morning, and then we'll build in the chance of some scattered storms later on this afternoon during the peak heating of the day. And you can see that on TrueCast here, how these storms just start to pop up anywhere, I would say, after 2 o'clock this afternoon, and then they'll be with us off and on throughout the evening hours. And even into the overnight hours, it does look like some of these storms could hang around for a little while. Not expecting severe weather, but obviously if you're out and about, at the pool or on a lake or maybe just out for a walk through the neighborhood. If you see lightning or you hear thunder, make sure you get back indoors and to a safe place as quick as possible. Temperatures this morning, 60s and 70s. It's really warm out there. It's extremely muggy. Highs today anywhere between 85 and 90 degrees as we start to build in the storms. But the humidity is just going to remain sky high here throughout the course of the next couple days. And really this entire week, we're going to be in the very humid to oppressive category. So the end of June, beginning of July, we're in the heart of summer here, and it's definitely going to feel like it. Temperatures are going to top off tomorrow in the upper 80s. It's a little cooler tomorrow because a little more in the way of cloud cover. This is TrueCast as we work our way throughout the day tomorrow, and you can see more in the way of scattered storms off and on throughout the day. The good news in this forecast is by the time we get to Friday and then the holiday weekend, well, yes, there will be some storm chances in the forecast. It goes down to only about a 20% chance of a spot storm over the weekend. That is the good news. Going to be very summer-like as well, temperature-wise, with highs that'll be in the mid to upper 80s. Lauren?
All right, Todd, thanks so much. Let's take a look right now at I-70. This is near State Road 267. You can see some flashing lights there on the right side of your screen. We do have some construction on I-70 this morning. And keep in mind, the westbound lanes of I-70 are closed again this week. That is between the South Split all the way over towards Ronald Reagan Parkway. You can use the Ronald Reagan Parkway ramp there from I-465 to get to the airport, or you can continue northbound on I-465 as part of your detour route. Just plan ahead, and if you're heading into the downtown area and you normally take the South Split to get on Meridian Street there to get into downtown, the local traffic there is open. You just cannot continue westbound on I-70. We'll continue to monitor any construction, any crashes or delays throughout your Monday, and of course, we'll keep you updated.
So, Lauren, I can't wait to tell you about this story. A random act of kindness that nearly moved a sheriff's deputy to tears. After the break, how a group of teens made this officer's day. That story and much more coming up on Good Morning Indiana.
/ First Responders First.
It is 5:56. A sheriff's deputy in Alabama was moved to tears by a random act of kindness from three teens.
So, Lauren, I want you to meet Deputy Manuel Stone. He was out in getting a quick lunch out and about. He serves in Lee County, Alabama. And this happened. Some good stuff happened involving those young people. He received a note that read, "We have paid for your meal as a thank you for your service to the community." He was simply moved, and he believes that gestures like this can bring us closer together. I believe that kindness, Lauren, will always win.
That's a great story there, and thankful for his service. We do want to get a check of our forecast right now with Todd.
Pretty quiet this morning, Lauren. We've had a couple thunderstorms down near Bloomington as well as Bedford. Those are coming to an end. Otherwise, it is just very warm and muggy this morning. Where are we going throughout the day? Well, back up close to 90 degrees for your high temperature. Better storm chances actually as we get into the afternoon hours. Not expecting severe weather. And outside of those storm chances, sunshine will be mixed in. But that humidity sky high throughout the day today. The time is 5:57. This is Good Morning Indiana. Stay with us. We're back at the top of the hour.